Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
That's enough for sit-ups, I think. Remember when we talked about getting exercise every day? Well, that goes for me, too. Oh, I've got one more exercise to do that's just great for your heart and your lungs and your leg muscles. I know. Why don't you join me? It's called jogging. All right, then. Okay, everybody up and start running in place. Don't bump into your neighbor. Knees nice and high. Come on. That's it. Good. Okay, stop. You can sit down again. Now, quick, tell me, what is everyone in this room doing right now? Can't you guess? Breathing, that's right. Everyone in the room is breathing. And I'll bet you're breathing a little bit harder than you normally do, right? I know I am. Let's see. Can you stop breathing if you want to? I know you can hold your breath for a few seconds. Can you hold your breath while I say the alphabet from A to Z? Why not try it? Ready? Take a deep breath. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, Z. How many of you made it? Good, I see lots of you did. And weren't you glad to take your next breath? Now, what does this show us? Yes, it shows us that we have to breathe all the time. And since we have to breathe all the time, it's a good thing our body takes care of it for us. It's a little place back here in our brain that really takes care of it for us. Wouldn't it be a nuisance if when you got up in the morning, you had to say to yourself, let's see. Oh, yes, I must remember to breathe today. Why do you suppose you have to breathe? Why do you have to take this stuff, air, into your body? Maybe this will help show us. Light the candle. When a candle burns, it's burning up some kind of fuel. And that fuel for the candle is wax, candle wax. Your body, too, burns some kind of fuel. And you know what your fuel is. Of course, it's food. Now, when the candle burns, does it need something else to help it burn? Let's find out. I'll cover the candle with this jar. When I cover the candle, what am I doing to it? Aren't you smart? Yes, I'm taking away the supply of fresh air that's reaching the candle. Now, watch the flame. It's getting smaller and smaller and smaller. Boop, it went out. Why? If you don't know, listen carefully. Just as the candle needs fuel, it also needs a special gas that's found in fresh air in order to burn the fuel. That special gas is oxygen. Have you heard of it? Then you say it. Oxygen. Your body needs oxygen, too, in order for you to burn the fuel that you have, which is food. You can't see or smell oxygen, but for you and for all animals, it's the most important part of the gas in the air around you. Without it, your cells would die. You have to have oxygen in order to stay alive. Why, it's so important that people who go places where there isn't any oxygen have to take it with them. Astronauts have to carry tanks of air containing oxygen when they go into outer space. Walking around on the moon, they carry tanks of air on their backs because there isn't any oxygen on the moon. Here's someone else who has to carry air with him. This diver is exploring the bottom of the ocean, and he wants to stay underwater longer than he can hold his breath. So he carries a tank containing oxygen with him. See those bubbles? That's his used air being breathed out. You aren't playing on the moon or on the ocean floor yet, but you might know a place like this. And your parents have told you, and I'm telling you again, never, never lock yourself or hide yourself in a small closed place like an icebox or a trunk. Nod your head if you understand why. Yes, because there isn't much air inside any of these places. If you used up all the oxygen inside, then you would be in serious trouble. If oxygen is so important, how does it get into your body? Well, there are two ways, two doors for the air to get into your body. See if you can guess. Mm-hmm. Your nose and your mouth. If you close your mouth, you can still breathe through your nose. Try it. And if your nose is closed up, let's say with a bad cold, then you can still breathe through your mouth. Try that. And where does the air that goes in these two doors go to after that? Does it go into your food tube? If it did, then it would go into your stomach, and you know that it doesn't go there. That's where your fuel goes. So there must be another tube for the air to go down. Yes, there is, and it's called the windpipe. All the air that you breathe in and out goes down and up the windpipe. You can feel the windpipe. Put your hands here. Feel those hard ridges? They're helping to hold the windpipe open. Oh, I know. Here's a model that will help explain and help show you what your windpipe really looks like. Now then, see this? That's your windpipe. See these rings here? They're helping to hold it open. Those were the hard ridges that you felt right here. Now this part, sitting up on top, is the voice box. Put your finger here, put your head back a little, and hum. You can feel the jiggling or vibrating of your voice box when you use it. You might even call it your noise box. You use your voice box in order to hum or sing or talk. Now, heads up again, and let's see where the windpipe leads to. There it goes. It branches like the trunk of a tree. It splits into two branches, with each one going into one of these pink soft organs called, do you know? Your lungs, right. I'll open one up. There. See these white things? There. That's one of the branches, branching again and again, and getting smaller and smaller each time it branches. If you were to take all these white things and the windpipe out of your lungs, it would look like a tree turned upside down. There would even be twigs at the ends of the smallest branches, and at the end of each twig would be very, very tiny balloon-like things called air sacs. That's why real lungs are soft and spongy. There are millions of air sacs in your lungs. They're soft and spongy, sort of like whipped jello or angel food cake. It's because there are so many pockets of air in them. When the air you breathe in gets into these air sacs, the oxygen in it goes into the blood that's passing close to the air sac. Here you see the white oxygen going into the bloodstream from the air sac. And there's something else happening at the same time. You see the dark used air going the other way. It's going from the bloodstream and into the air sac. That's your used air, and when you breathe out, all that used air goes out of your body. Each of the air sacs is very, very tiny. You couldn't even see a real one without a microscope. But if you added up all of the air sacs and all of their air, how much do you think there would be? Do you think that your lungs hold a lot of air or a little? I know how we can find out. I'll take this milk bottle and turn it upside down in the water. Oops, it's tippy. It'll tip over right away. So I'm going to fill it with water. Hear the air coming out? Do I have most of it out? There. Now I'll turn the water jug upside down, and it stands there without any trouble at all. Okay? Next, I'm going to take this rubber tube and put it inside the neck of the milk bottle. Shove it up pretty far, because you don't want it to come slipping out. And then take a deep breath and blow. Okay, I'll stop. Now I'll cover the bottom of the milk bottle with my hand and lift the jar out. Aha! You see what happened? What? Yes, when I blew my air into the bottle, I forced all the water out. Now the bottle is full of air again, but this time it's full of air that was in my lungs. So you see, all those air sacs in your lungs really do hold a lot of air, don't they? You can do this easy experiment yourself. You can find out how much air your lungs can hold. But of course, normally, we don't pay any attention to the air we breathe out. It's just, you know, something that you do without thinking about it at all. But every once in a while, on special occasions, that used air becomes very important. Why? What would happen if on your birthday you couldn't take a deep breath and
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
hear that? Can you guess what that mystery sound is? It's made by a special part of your body, every second of the day and night. Do you need some more clues? Well, people sing songs about it. They sing about how they've lost their, and where they left their, and how their is breaking. But I'll bet you've guessed already, right away. Even though you may not have known that it looked like this, that it's your heart beating over and over and over again, like the ticking of a clock. That sound you heard is the sound the doctor hears when he puts a stethoscope to your chest. How can you feel your own heart beating? Well, maybe if you're very still, you can feel it. Put your hand here, a little to the side, and press hard. You may have to slide it around a little bit to find it. Can you feel it beating? If it's a little hard to feel, remember, your heart is in a cage. It's protected inside your rib cage. Suppose your doctor took an X-ray picture of your chest. This is what you would see. The white things are the bones of your rib cage. And that dark shadow moving there, almost in the middle, is your heart. It sounds like the beating of a drum, doesn't it? Well, it may sound like a drum, but it works more like a pump. And the way a pump works is really very simple. Here's one kind of pump that pumps liquid from one place to another. Watch what happens if I squeeze and let go for a little bit. Whoa, there it goes. You see? It sucks up liquid from one bowl, up the tube, through the middle piece, out the other tube, and into the other bowl. Squeeze, let go, squeeze, let go, squeeze, let go. And did you notice this? That it's always moving in the same direction. This one way, like a one-way street. Your heart works in much the same way, your special pump. But with this special difference, it never can rest or stop. It has to keep pumping all day and all night. It only has to pump this much liquid, 5 quarts. But it has to keep pumping that over and over and over again, over 2,000 times in just one day. But your heart doesn't pump colored liquid. What does it pump? Gasoline? Air? No? What then? Your blood. That's right. Let's take a closer look at your heart, your own special pump. Probably the first thing you noticed is that it's not shaped like a Valentine heart. As you can see, it's not pointed at one end, and it's not evenly shaped. In fact, it's rather lopsided. And your heart isn't this big either. This is a giant-sized heart. But how big is yours? Make a fist. Good. Look at it. Your fist is about the size of your heart. And my fist is about the size of my heart. My heart is bigger than your heart because hearts grow as people grow. Now, your heart doesn't have hooks on it, but it is hollow, like this one. In fact, your heart is divided into 1, 2, 3, 4 parts or rooms. And there are doors between the rooms, here and here, that help keep the blood moving in the right direction. These doors are called valves. And you might be interested to know that the lub-dub sound your heart makes is really the sound of these valves opening and closing, letting the blood go through. And what is your heart with its 4 rooms made of? Well, think now. What is it that makes your arms move and your fingers wiggle and your eyes blink? What is it? Muscle. That's right. Your heart is made of muscle, too. And this amazing muscle, your heart, works in a way like this. When the muscle walls of your heart relax, blood rushes into them. Blood rushes into the heart. And when the walls contract or squeeze together, the blood is pushed out. The walls go out, in, out, in, out, in. Why don't you try it? Look, like this. Maybe you can even hear or feel the sound of the air being pumped out of your hands. But that's air. What about your blood? How does it get in and out of your heart? Let's see if we can find any special openings in the heart that would let the blood go in and out. Just want to put it together first. Okay, what are these tube-like things? Here, and here, and here. Raise your hand if you think they have something to do with letting the blood in and out of your heart. Okay, hands down. You're absolutely right. These things are blood vessels, and blood vessels are the tunnels or the pipes that all your blood goes through when it travels throughout your body. There are some blood vessels that bring blood to the heart. They're called veins. And then there are other blood vessels that carry blood away from the heart, and they're called arteries. Now, your heart has more than one opening. Let's see. Right here, there's an opening that lets blood come into the heart. That's a vein. And then, right about here on the inside, is an opening that lets blood go out of your heart. And that's an artery. When your heart beats, what it does, it squeezes blood out and into the arteries in a sort of spurting way, like the hand pump did with the colored water. Remember? You can feel your own blood spurting by putting your thumb and your fingers right here. See if you can feel the two large arteries that go up to your head and that feed your brain. Can you feel the blood pumping? Okay, when you do, start counting aloud and stop when you reach eight. Ready? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Okay, everybody stop. If you could look through a microscope at a blood vessel, this is what you would see. Look at that. You can see the separate blood cells moving along. Isn't that amazing? And look at this. You can actually see the pulse of the blood as the heart pumps it. It moves in a stop and go sort of way, like traffic. The blood in your blood vessels has to carry food and oxygen and water to all the cells in your body, your brain cells, your muscle cells, bone cells, your skin cells, all the cells. And the blood also has to carry away the waste materials that all those cells make. If your blood stopped moving, either everywhere or in just one part of your body, the cells would begin to die. So, blood vessels have to go to all parts of your body. They run from your heart like roads and highways. Some of them go into your arms, and others go down to the lower part of your body and branch into your legs. Along the way, the roads turn into streets and side streets and alleys and footpaths. The blood vessels get smaller as they go away from the heart, and they get larger as they feed back toward the heart. Some of them are no thicker than your thumb. Well, as thick as your thumb. And others are thinner than a hair. I know. Take just one hair on your head and feel it. Just to remind you how thin that is. Thin? That's right. But not all are that thin. Some of them you can see. Now let's see. Where could you see them? Yes, all right. Let's try our arms. Make a fist. That helps. and see if you can find the blood vessels near your wrist, the ones the doctor uses when he takes your pulse. Do you feel those little lines there? All right, well, follow them up your arm toward your elbow. There they go. Now, this is interesting. They get a little bit thicker, and there are fewer of them as they go up your arm. You see, these are veins that are heading back towards your heart. And then, well, finally, they just disappear, and you can't see them anymore. But you know they're there, just as you know your heart is there, pumping your blood all around your body. In fact, your heart was beating inside you even before you were born, when you were just a baby growing inside your mother. And it will still be beating inside you, doing its important job, when you are an old, old lady or an old, old man. Your blood is somewhat like this little engine. That sound funny? The little engine here has a battery inside it that keeps it moving, just as your heart keeps your blood moving, making round trips to all parts of your body, never stopping. It goes round and round, picking up water and fuel in your intestines, and picking up oxygen in your lungs, and delivering these things to all the other cells in your body. Oh, yes, and picking up waste to carry it away. On and on it goes. Driven by that mighty muscle, your heart.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
To have, but you know there are a lot of care too. Somebody has to feed them, give them water, see that they get exercise, and every so often somebody has to clean up after them, and that's what I'm doing right now. The gerbil's cage is smelly. Oh, the shavings are wet and the floor is dirty. It really is time to get rid of this stuff and to give the gerbils a nice clean place to live. This stuff that we think of as dirty, this waste, it really came from what the gerbils ate. But you knew that already, didn't you? All animals must eat, and so all animals have to make waste.
Big animals like elephants, middle-sized animals like dogs and goats, little animals like the gerbils and earthworms. Oh, yes, and even the kind of animals that you can see only with a microscope. Let's pretend we're looking through a microscope right now. See those brownish shapes that look something like commas floating around? These are tiny one-celled animals called stentors. Tiny as it is, the stentor must do the same things you do in order to stay alive. It eats and it makes waste. Here's the rounded end of a stentor. Now watch that circle-shaped part in the middle. It sort of swirls and bubbles and goes blip. When it does that, it's getting rid of waste. Whoops. There it goes. What it's getting rid of is mostly water, but there's also some solid waste in it, too, that came from what the stentor ate. Now, what about you, a many-celled animal? What do? Well, you certainly don't wrap yourself around your food to digest it, and you don't just bubble and blip out the part you can't use. What do? Here's Danny eating an ice cream cone. Boy, oh boy, is that a whopper. But lick, lap, bite, and swallow, that ice cream, cone and all, will soon disappear inside Danny. Then what? What happens to any food that anybody eats? Let's take a look at our model and see if you remember how your food is digested. Let's find out how much you know. Well, first of all, the food you eat goes in here, where it's wet by all the juices in your mouth and chomped by your teeth and swallowed. Then it goes down the food tube and into your stomach, where it's mixed with some more juices. And it's mushed and squashed and squeezed along into this long coiled up organ called, do you remember? Your intestine. And there it's mixed with some more digestive juices until it's so soupy and liquid that it simply goes out of the walls of your intestine and into your blood. Then what? Well, your blood carries it to all parts of your body, to your million, billion, trillion cells. And your cells need the food and water and oxygen that your blood brings to them to help them grow and simply to stay alive. Well, that's quite a story, the story of how your food is digested. And good for you, you remembered it. Now, here's a question. Think, don't let me catch you. Nod your head yes or no if you think that all the food you eat can be digested. Ah, you're thinking, no, it can't. Some parts of the meat and fruits and vegetables you eat are too stringy and tough to be digested. Your cells can't use it, your body can't use it, all it is waste. So your body takes this stuff that it can't digest and it stores it here in the large intestine or bowel. And then after a while, it moves all this stuff out as solid waste. Your body gets rid of solid waste every day or two. What would happen if you didn't get rid of the solid waste? Well, the waste would build up. Pretty soon there wouldn't be room for any more, and you would be quite uncomfortable. So far all we've talked about is what happens to the solid waste, the food that can't be digested. What about the digested food? The food that's carried by your blood to all parts of your body, to your cells. What do your cells do with it? Well, each cell in your body is something like a little factory. It uses the oxygen to burn the food to give it energy to do its work. And when your cells do this, they make waste, which must be gotten rid of. This waste is carried away from all the cells by your blood. One kind of waste, called carbon dioxide, is carried by your blood to your lungs, where you breathe it out and exchange it for fresh oxygen. Do this. Breathe in. fresh oxygen goes in. Now, breathe out. Carbon dioxide goes out. Raise your hand if you've ever heard of carbon dioxide before. Oh, some of you have. Fine, hands down. Well, every time you breathe in oxygen, and you breathe out this waste called carbon dioxide. While oxygen is going into your body, the used air, and you know the name of it now, carbon dioxide, is going out. You have to keep getting rid of the carbon dioxide waste over and over, day and night. Why is this important? Well, do you remember the candle that I covered with a jar? What happened when all the oxygen was used up and all that was left was carbon dioxide? Yes, it went out. It didn't burn anymore. Your cells will die too if you don't get enough fresh oxygen in and get rid of the carbon dioxide waste. Your factories would close down. Now, what about the rest of the waste your cells make? What's left? Liquid waste. Cleaning liquid waste out of your blood is so important that your body has a whole set of organs just to take care of liquid waste. Two of these are your kidneys and your bladder. Where are your kidneys? Oh, can we find them on the model? Let's see. Yes, here they are. Here's one, and here's the other. They're a little bit hard to see, but they're shaped like large beans. I wonder, let's see if you can locate the kidneys on your own body. Do this. Sit forward in your seat and put your hands here on your waist with your thumbs pointing forward like this. And your fingers just slightly above your belt line. Now the tips of your fingers are over your kidneys. No, you can't feel them, I know, but they're there. Right beside the backbone, one on each side. Okay, sit down and let's see if we can find out a little bit more about what your kidneys look like and the kind of work they do. Here's the model of one kidney. It's larger than yours, but it will help you understand the work your kidneys do. And what do your kidneys do? They clean your blood. How do they do this? Well, first of all, your blood gathers up all the waste material from the cells and it sends it to your kidneys. Blood carrying waste goes into the kidney here through this blood vessel. The kidney takes out the waste and some of the water in your blood and then sends the cleaned blood back out. Back to your heart through this blood vessel here. And this is where the liquid waste called urine drains off. Your body sending your blood to your kidneys is something like you sending your dirty clothes to the cleaners. Only your kidney cleaners are never closed. They are open day and night, taking in dirty blood, cleaning it, and sending it out again, over and over. Imagine that you were sitting right now in a bathtub filled with water up to your belly button, or maybe even higher, up to here. That's a lot of liquid, isn't it? Well, that's about how much liquid your body sends to your kidney cleaners every day. Those little kidneys really have to work, don't they? Now, we still haven't answered the question, how do your kidneys do their work? Well, inside each kidney are a million little tiny strainers or filters, more than you could ever count. These tiny strainers filter out the waste from your blood. Let's see if we can get a better idea of how a filter works. Here I have some dirty water and a piece of filter paper. The filter paper is just full of lots of little holes. No, you can't see them, they're too small. I'm going to fold the filter paper and fit it into the funnel, like that. Now, I'm going to pour the dirty water through the filter, and you watch down here. Okay? There. See what's happening? Watch some more. What is happening? Right you are. The water is coming through clean again. The filter paper removes the waste from the dirty water, just like your kidney filters remove the waste and a little water from your blood. Well, that's all fine. But where does it go after it leaves the kidneys? What happens to this liquid waste? Here, I'll show you. The filters inside these, the bean-shaped kidneys, take in blood through here and here and clean it, taking out the waste and some of the water, and then they send the clean blood out here and here. Well, what's left over, the liquid waste called urine, goes down these two long tubes to your bladder. This is your bladder. It's like a stretchy rubber bag that stores urine. About how much urine does the bladder hold usually? Oh, about a cupful. The urine goes into the bladder slowly, just a little bit at a time. And when the bladder is full, you go to the bathroom and get rid of it. And when you gotta go, you gotta go. So there you have it. The blood goes in and out of your kidneys, and the liquid waste goes down. And what do you suppose would happen if you didn't get rid of this liquid waste? Well, the waste would clog up your blood so that your cells wouldn't get as much food and oxygen as they needed. Your cells would die, and you would be very sick. So you see, your kidneys are very important organs. You couldn't stay alive without them. Your body has got to get rid of waste. And now you know how it gets rid of three kinds: undigested food, carbon dioxide, and urine. And you also know a little bit more about yourself and about how your wonderful body works to keep you healthy and growing and alive. It's fun to learn about yourself. Don't you think so? Good. See you next time.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
You're wondering what I'm doing with all these bags. Well, I was just cleaning out my closet and I found them all in there. I didn't know I had so many. Goodness. I like bags. Funny, weird, crazy, useful bags. But you know what? The funniest, craziest, weirdest, most useful one of all is the one that's part of me. I'm inside it right now. You're in one too. You have been ever since the day you were born. Some people call it your birthday suit. Now can you guess? Your skin, of course. Remember when you were just a little kid, what fun it was running around in just your birthday suit? Even now, it's fun to swim and play with lots of your birthday suit showing. The hot sun feels good on your skin, doesn't it? And the cool water, too. But what about all that splashing? Won't the water get inside you and slosh around and make you uncomfortable? Mm-mm. Your skin is like a good raincoat. It doesn't leak. Water doesn't get into your body through your skin because your skin is waterproof. Well, what else is special about that birthday suit of yours? How does it fit? Is it loose like the saggy, baggy elephant skin? Let's see. Is it loose here? Feel. Here? Why is it in some places looser? Let's feel some more. Pinch here. And here. Could you bend your arm all the way if your skin were really tight? Pinch the loose skin at your elbow and try it. Oh. Hmm. Well, let go and try it again. Oh, you see? At the places where you bend, at your joints, your skin has to be looser. And it is. So it seems that your skin fits just right, doesn't it? But there's a lot more to it than that. If you could take just a teeny tiny square of skin, like from the back of your hand, for example, just a teeny piece, and make it look bigger, this is what it would look like. Now, what do you think all these funny-looking things are sticking out here? That's right, they're little hairs, just like on the back of your hand. And that gives you some idea of just how huge this model is. And this part down here, that shows what's underneath your skin, if you could slice it like a piece of cake. And that looks big, too, because on you, this piece of skin is no thicker than, well, feel your thumbnail. It's no thicker than your nail. Close to the surface of your skin are these things, blood vessels carrying blood. See? And that's why when you cut your finger, you bleed. Like a cake, your skin is made in layers. The top layer, your frosting, is very, very thin. Here it is, up on top. This top layer is made of dead, dry skin cells. And it works something like the plastic wrap I put around food before I put it away in the refrigerator. This top layer keeps the dirt and germs out of your body, and it keeps your body from drying up. You know, this top layer I was just talking about is always falling off and flaking away every day. Look at your hands. You know what? You're not even looking at the same skin on your hands that you looked at yesterday. Because every time you washed and dried your skin, you shed some tiny dry pieces of skin. But that's nothing to worry about, because just as the old cells are falling away, the living cells in the layer below, right here, this second layer, are growing new cells to take their place. You are growing new skin all the time. Isn't it lucky that you shed your skin the way you do? Otherwise, you might do what the snake does. It sheds its skin every few months and all in one piece. Look at this one from a rather large snake called the boa constrictor. Whew. No, let's look at this one from a smaller snake. Now that's my size. This is a skin that a snake left behind. When it got too tight and uncomfortable, the snake just wiggled out and left it behind, turned inside out, the way you do sometimes when you take off your clothes. I know, we can make up a riddle. What part of your body keeps growing all your life, even after it's gotten as big as it's ever going to be? What's the answer? Your skin. Good for you. Okay. Now, here's a harder riddle. what grows in your skin while your skin is growing? Give up? Your hair. That's the answer. Let's take a look at the model and follow a hair from the end to the beginning. The end, of course, would be the end that you see. And we'll follow it down here, there. This part that grows underneath, like the root of a blade of grass, is called that. It's called a root. And this end is the end that your hair grows from. This is where the new hair cells are added. Each hair grows up through a hole in your skin. And if you pull one out, another one grows in its place. Does it hurt to pull your hair? Okay, you know. Let's take just one hair and pull it. And does that hurt? Ouch! Yes, it does. Why does it hurt? See that thing right there, wrapped around the root of the hair? That's a nerve. And when you pulled your hair, a nerve sent a message of pain to your brain. Nerves are starting stations for messages going to your brain. You have nerve endings everywhere, all over your body, just under the top layer of skin. They tell your brain what they feel is going on outside your body. They even send weather reports. They tell you you're too hot or too cold, and sometimes you just put a sweater on or take one off. Oh, but something else happens besides that. Do you see this thing here curled up like a tube? That's a sweat gland. You have them in almost every part of your skin. They help keep the temperature of your body just right. They help keep it from getting too high. This is how it works. When you're too warm, the sweat gland opens up and it pushes water out through a tiny hole in your skin called a pore. Here, you can see the pores on the top side of the skin. There, there, see them everywhere? All right. Well, sweating puts water on your skin. And when the water dries, you feel cooler. Your sweat glands are your own private cooling system. Is everyone's skin alike? How are human skins different? What have you noticed? Yes, that's true. Some children have medium brown skin. And some have much lighter, in fact, almost pinkish skin. Some children have tan skin. And some are a lighter tan than that. And some are brown. Some are dark. People do come in all different colors. And why do you think that the color of one person's skin is different from another? Well, in your skin, there are some cells with a special job to do. Their job is to make grains of color. Some people's cells make more grains of color than others. And the more grains of color you have in your skin, the darker it is. You know, it's like mixing paint. Let's see. If you take just a pinch of powdered paint, those are grains of color, stir it. See? It colors the water, right? Now watch. If you keep adding more color, more powdered paint, more grains of color, what happens? Yes, it gets darker. But of course, this is one color people don't come in, blue. But we do know that people in different parts of the world have different color skins. And we also know that the color of a person's skin has nothing to do with what that person is like as a person. The difference, you see, is only skin deep. Well now, that wonderful birthday suit of yours does many nice things for you. Let's see, it wraps you up, keeps you from drying out, protects you from dirt and germs. It puts you in touch with things. It helps keep your temperature just right. And it gives you your color. Oh, but not blue, I hope. And what do for your skin? You wash it. You wash your hands and your face and your whole birthday suit. Just as often as possible, don't you? Don't you? Washing your skin gets rid of dirt and germs and sweat. Oh, and it makes you feel so good. Shiny, clean skin and squeaky, clean hair not only feel good, they look good, too. So, you see, you really are very lucky to have such a beautiful birthday suit. Take care of it always, won't you?
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Have been sitting here on this shelf ever since we began talking about the wonderful ways your body works. Do you think they have learned anything from what we've been talking about? What do they know? Anything about anything? Why not? Raggedy Ann and Andy are very pleasant rag dolls, but they aren't living things with the ability you have to know. And they don't have the equipment you have to find out about the world around them. What equipment do you have? How come you know so much? Well, first of all, you have a brain that lets you learn and remember what you've learned. And then you have eyes to see with, nose to smell with, ears to hear with, tongue to taste with, and skin all over your body to feel with. All of these organs, your eyes, ears, nose, tongue, skin, are all part of your body equipment. They are called your sense organs. They sense or feel what's going on in the world outside your body. Their job is to report to your brain and tell it what it needs to know to keep you alive. How do these messages get to your brain? How do the messages from outside your body get to your brain, inside your body? They travel on a network of nerves. Big nerves, like cables. Medium-sized nerves, like wires. Tiny nerves, like fine threads, run everywhere, all over your body. And as you can see, many of them begin and end in your sense organs. They carry thousands of messages to and from your brain every minute. And what messages are your sense organs sending to your brain right now? What about your eyes? What are they doing? They're taking pictures. Nerves in the back of your head are sending messages to your brain about what I'm wearing, where I'm standing, what I'm holding in my hand. Your eyes are like cameras, taking pictures of me and everything around me. And what are they doing with these messages, your eyes? They're sending them to your brain, right. And this may be a little hard to understand, but your eyes have to send a message to your brain before you can see something. Your brain is just a big grayish ball of cells shut up in your skull. It's dark in there. Without your eyes sending sight messages from the outside world, you can't see anything. Your brain can't see any pictures on its own. It needs your eyes. And without your brain, your eyes are like two cameras without any film in them. Oh, you can squint and blink and click, but you don't have any picture. What you see tells you a lot about the world around you. And sometimes it gives you a very special feeling, too. Imagine never being able to see anything as beautiful as a sunset. Without your eyes and your brain working together, you couldn't see a sunset or anything else. What other senses are you using right now? What sense organ? Your ears, right. You are hearing what I'm saying, I hope. And if somebody near you is whispering or shuffling their feet, you're hearing that too, aren't you? Shh. Feel your ears. They stick out from your head, don't they? Can you guess why they're built this way? To trap sounds into your brain. Can you make them stick out more? Yes, if you cup your hands around them like this, then you can trap sounds better. But suppose you didn't have these sound traps to hear with. It would make the world a very different place. Without your ears sending you sound messages, you couldn't hear anything at all. Your brain and your ears must work together. Well, you're seeing me with your eyes, and you're hearing me with your ears. Are you using any other senses right now? Is your sense of touch working? How? You probably have to stop and think about that for a minute. Well, is your seat touching the seat of your chair? Is your seat on your seat? Well, how does your chair or whatever you're sitting on feel? Raise your hand if it feels hard, like what I'm sitting on. Okay, hands down. And how would it feel if you were sitting in a chair like this? Yes, very soft. So you see, your body can tell the difference between things that are soft and things that are hard. And your body can also tell the difference between hot water and cold water, rough things like sandpaper, smooth like this tabletop, fuzzy like the silky elephant. And painful like the stiff brush. And as you probably know by now, the nerve endings in your skin send the messages, but it's really your brain that feels. In fact, did you know that you can tell what something is just by feeling it? Hey, I wonder what's in this bag. It's something round, and soft. It has a hole in the middle. It feels a little bit greasy. It feels like a donut. It smells like a donut. It tastes like a donut. It is a donut. Tasting good things to eat, like donuts, makes life more enjoyable. Your tongue is really a very important sense organ. But funny as it sounds, you know, it's really your brain that does the tasting. If the taste buds on your tongue, those little rough bumps you feel on your tongue, if they didn't send messages to your brain, you wouldn't know what sweet, sour, salty, bitter, or spicy meant. And just as important, especially when you're eating, is your sense of smell. If you've ever had a cold in the nose, then you know how hard it is to taste anything when your nose is stuffed up. Of course, it's not just the taste of food that makes life more exciting. Imagine never being able to smell flowers. Or to see them. Or to touch them. How does the wonderful smell of flowers get to your brain? Well, your nose, you might say, is something like the nozzle of a vacuum cleaner. It scoops up smells like a vacuum cleaner scoops up dirt. And then, nerves at the back of your nose send those smell messages to your brain. Well, how come you know so much? Because from the day that you were born, you have been receiving millions and millions of messages a day. And your brain has been busy recording everything you see, hear, smell, taste, or feel. I never would have known that good-tasting food was a donut if I hadn't seen one before and remembered it. Your sense organs are the best teaching machines in the world. That's how come you know so much. But suppose, starting today, this minute, you could no longer use your sense organs. How much would you know? Well, yes, you'd know, your brain would know what it knows now. But how much more would you learn if your senses weren't telling your brain anything? Wouldn't it be like spending the rest of your life in a black box like this one? Don't worry, I won't be gone long. Oh my gosh, it's black in here. I can't see a thing. Ooh. There's no way any sight messages are going from my eyes to my brain. Oh, well, there's nothing special to see anyway. And I can't hear anything. Except myself. Oh, well, but there's nothing in the room making noise anyway. Is there? I'm hungry. Too bad there's nothing to eat. There isn't even anything to smell. I wish I could smell those flowers again. Golly, I thought my room was empty until I got in here. I'd like just to walk around and touch all my favorite things. I have such nice things in my room. This is nothing. Where did I ever get an idea to try this experiment? This is really dull. Besides, I I'm getting lonesome. I think before I lose my senses, I'll come out and use my senses. See? Just what I thought. Nothing happened while I was in there. Ah! What? What happened here? What's going on? Who did this? Oh, somebody has made such a mess. See what happens when you aren't able to use your senses? I have no idea what went on out here while I was in the black box. And I guess I'll never know.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Call you a brain? What did they mean? Did they mean you look like this? No, of course not. What did they mean then? They meant you use your brain well. Now, tell me, what do you use your brain for? To think, yes. What else? To solve problems. You do a lot of that. To learn, to remember, right? To ask questions? Mm-hmm. To daydream? Sure, why not? And what about to hear and see and walk and talk? Without your brain, you could do none of these things. But your brain can't do all these things by itself. It must have help to do what it needs to do. And your brain's special helpers are your five... What? Do you remember? Your five senses, right. This fellow over here has no senses at all. Let's go see if we can help him out. Here's a clue. Hot or cold, pinch or pin. To find out which, just ask your skin, right. So, let's give this dummy some skin and a beautiful head of hair. Next, for seeing things, it's no surprise. You certainly have to use your eyes. Right. So, let's have some eyes. One. Two. Okay. Whispers, speeches, shouts, cheers. To hear them all, just open your ears. Good. Okay. So here's an ear on one side and another ear. Small as a button or big as a rose, everyone, everywhere needs a Nose. Good. Here's a nice, big, blue nose. Now, last one. East or west, north or south, where you taste is in your mouth. Right. So, give dummy a mouth. Oh, my goodness, what a weird-looking thing that is. Without your sense organs, your brain wouldn't be able to hear, see, taste, smell, or feel anything. It wouldn't know any more than this dummy here. And without a brain, you'd be a dummy. Your brain is a giant control center, sending and receiving messages all the time. It's part of a network of nerves that runs down your spinal cord and all over your body. Some nerves send messages to your brain from your sense organs. Other nerves send messages from your brain to your muscles. Now, suppose a fly were sitting on the end of your nose. How would you know a fly were sitting on the end of your nose? How would your brain know it? Well, his little feet would tickle the nerve endings in your nose, and the message, "Fly is sitting on me," would travel over the nerve network to your brain. And what would your brain do about it? Do it. Right. Your brain would send the message to your arm muscles, "Swat that fly," and you did. Now, here's a tricky question. Raise your hand if you think your brain does something besides send and receive messages. Yes, it does. Good for you. Hands down. It also stores information. Your brain is like a gigantic warehouse that keeps information until you need to use it. You have two kinds of memory, a short-time memory and a long-time memory. Things you don't need to remember are quickly forgotten. But things you do need to remember, like your name, where you live, your telephone number, things that you repeat many times, they become part of your long-time memory. What would happen if you didn't have a long-time memory? Then you'd have to learn the same things over and over again. You wouldn't have time to learn anything new. Nobody knows for sure just exactly what goes on inside your head when you learn. But you know yourself that you learn some things by trying and making mistakes and remembering and trying again. In fact, all animals do the same thing. And when they're learning new things, they use all their senses to help them. This rat, by using his senses, has already learned to find his way through a maze to get his lunch. Watch. There he goes. Oh my. Let's try it again. Good scratching of the ear always helps. Oh, there he goes. Even faster. Now, what about this fat fellow? He's never been through the maze before, but he loves to eat. Let's watch him use his senses to learn where his food is. Here he goes. Is he using his eyes? Yes, to see where he's going. Is he using his sense of touch? Yes, his feet tell him that he's touching the floor, and sometimes his whiskers touch the sides, and it helps him find his way along the wall. Is he using his nose? He seems to be sniffing everywhere he goes, doesn't he? Sniff, sniff. He he can smell that there's food around. Only problem is he can't see it. He's ready to climb walls for it. You know what? I'll bet in a few more tries, this rat will streak through the maze just like the first one did. Now he's using his sense of taste to prove that it's all worthwhile. You know where your brain is, don't you? Show me. Right. But do you think it looks like this model? Never in a million years. This model is a hard, gray, smooth, ugly plastic thing. Your living brain is soft, pink, bright pink, wrinkled, and it's made of living brain cells, billions of them. Your brain has separate places or clumps of cells, each with a job to do. On this model of the brain, let's locate some of those special places that do special things. Suppose on a hot day, there's a popcorn man selling popcorn across the street. This is the place, way up here at the front, where your brain first smells the popcorn. This is the place, here in the middle, where your brain hears the jingle of the bell on the popcorn man's cart. This is the place, way back here, where your brain sees the popcorn man. And then, way inside and down underneath, is the place where your brain feels hungry. So, your brain decides that you should go across the street. Your brain tells your muscles to move your bones and hurry up. Your brain will know that you are running, not walking or skipping across the street. And of course, there's a place in the brain that lets you know that the popcorn tastes good. Because you are human and need to learn to do so many things, your brain is more complicated than the brains of other animals. Let's look at the model again. Your brain is divided into three main parts. This part, the biggest part, with the swirly lines. See this part? Your upper brain is the part that lets you do things that only humans can do. It lets you talk and read and write. It lets you make things with your hands, invent, paint, make music. And it lets you understand all the many things that you understand. Underneath the big part of your brain is a smaller part, right here, the middle brain. The middle brain keeps your muscles moving together smoothly. Because of it, you can walk without stumbling, talk without mumbling, and write and draw pictures without scribbling. Also underneath the big part of your brain, and at the top of your spinal cord, is the lower brain, right here. This is sometimes called your animal brain, because this is the part that's most like the brains of other animals. Some very simple animals, like the earthworm, have only this part for a brain. It's the oldest part of your brain, the first part to grow before you were born. What does it do? Well, it takes care of all the things that your body is doing even when you are asleep. Breathing, digesting, swallowing, things like that. You never have to tell your heart to beat and your blood to move because this part of your brain takes care of all that for you. You know, you really are a brain. Yes, you are. Your brain is not just another organ in your body. It is you. And everything you are happens in your brain. And what goes on inside your brain makes you different from everyone else in the world. Every day, your brain helps you to be what you want to be and to do what you want to do. It's always working for you. Your own busy brain.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Did you know your eyes see me like this all the time? They do. It takes your brain to make me look like this. And that's one reason I've said you see with your brain. But of course, your eyes are very important. You learn an enormous amount about the world through your eyes. What do you know about how they work? Well, they're not as simple as they look. Your eye is made of many parts that work together to bring your brain a clear, sharp picture. Even if the picture is upside down. But how do these pictures get to your eyes? Let me give you a hint. You see? I moved and you didn't see me move because I turned out the lights. Pictures can only travel on light rays. You can only see if some light is entering your eye. And the way all this happens is really very interesting. Your eye is round, like a marble. Light goes first through the cornea, this part here. The cornea is tough and clear, like the glass that covers the face of a watch. The cornea covers the colored part of your eye, this part here. The iris does more than give you brown eyes or blue. It's made of tiny muscles that can open or close that black hole in the center. This hole is called the pupil. Your pupil isn't always the same size. It can get bigger to let more light in and smaller to shut light out. The next part light travels through is the lens. This is the lens. Yes, a camera has a lens too. Only this lens can change shape. Muscles are attached to the lens that can make it change shape so that you can focus or see a thing clearly, whether it's near your face or far away. After a picture goes through the lens, it goes through some jelly-like stuff in here to the back of your eye. The back of your eye is like a movie screen. It's called the retina. After the picture goes through the rest of the eye, it shows up here on the retina. And you know what? Yes, it's upside down. Just like the picture of me was a few minutes ago. All pictures would be upside down if your brain didn't take over and turn them right side up. What happens after the big nerve from the back of your eye to your brain takes over? Well, it sends a message to the right part of your brain. And the message might say, "Oh-ho! There's a teacher on television showing me a model of my eye. I'd better listen and look and see what I can learn." Suppose your pupils couldn't get smaller to shut some light out. If they didn't, and you went outside on a very bright day, this is what might happen. But, of course, that's not what happens, is it? The iris makes the pupil smaller, shutting out some light. Now suppose that your pupils couldn't get bigger to let more light in. If they didn't, and you went into a dimly lit room, it would seem like this. A dimly lit room would be a dark room if your pupils couldn't get bigger and let more light in. So far, we've talked about muscles that help you focus your eyes and muscles that control the amount of light going into your eyes. Are there other muscles? Yes. There are muscles attached to your eyeballs. Your eyes have to move together. Both eyes must move in the same direction at the same time for you to be able to see clearly. So you see, the muscles in your eyes are really very important. That's why you shouldn't read in the dark. You'll strain the muscles in your eyes. Your eyes need good light to read by. But even if you do take good care of your eyes, you still might start seeing things like this. Lots of things could be wrong. My friend Arlene was smart. When things started looking like this to her, she did something about it. Arlene first went to the oculist's office. An oculist is a doctor who checks to see if your eyes are healthy. Arlene sat in a big chair like this before when she had her eyes tested, so she isn't worried. Arlene keeps her glasses on and uses one eye at a time to read the letters on a chart on the wall. Then Arlene looks at some lights. She should see four dots if the muscles in each eye are doing their job. For the next test, Dr. Fricker uses something that looks like a plastic ruler. He is checking each eye to see how strong the muscles are. Next, Arlene wears some special glasses to look at some pictures in a book. A fly as big as a mouse stands right up on the page. Then Dr. Fricker shines a light in Arlene's eyes that helps tell him what kind of glasses she needs. The light makes Arlene see spots, but they go away in a minute. Dr. Fricker holds Arlene's head so she can't turn it and has her follow a stick with her eyes as he moves it from side to side. Arlene tells him when she can no longer see it. This shows the doctor how far Arlene's eye muscles will turn her eyes and how far she can see without turning her head. Next, Dr. Fricker has Arlene put her head and shoulders into a large machine. All Arlene can see is a funny camera-like thing that looks right back at her. Dr. Fricker looks into each eye to see if the cornea and lens are shaped as they should be. This is very important for good eyesight. Another light. This time, the doctor is going to look right inside Arlene's eye. He tilts her head back so he can see right down into the retina. This funny-looking pair of glasses is very heavy because it holds more than one lens. Arlene decides which lens helps her see the chart on the wall best. Maybe this one. Arlene has to look very carefully to be sure. Nope, these are the ones. Dr. Fricker will write a prescription for these lenses. So Arlene will get her new glasses that are just right. Arlene is proud of her new glasses and happy too, because things no longer look fuzzy to her. I think that she looks very nice in her new glasses too. Wow, wasn't that some sound? Fire engines are really loud, aren't they? Hey, wait a minute. How did I know it was a fire engine? I didn't even see it. I guess there's just one answer. My ears told me. As you know, your ears are the sense organs that catch and funnel sounds to your brain. Just like your eyes, Your ears help you to learn a lot of things. Your brain remembers what it hears as well as what it sees. I knew that was a fire engine because I've seen one before, and I've heard that siren and bell before. Lots of sounds, like the siren, reach your ears all the time. Have you ever wondered how they got there? Well, just as pictures travel to your eyes on light rays, sounds travel to your ears on sound waves. For your ears to hear anything at all, sound has to be carried to them. All sounds are made by something vibrating, that is, moving back and forth. Just like this rubber band. Can you see it? Can you hear it? Okay. Now, how did that sound get to your ears? If you think it traveled through the air, you are right. Sound travels through the air like ripples travel through water. Now, what about your sound equipment? What about these funny things that stick out from your head like wings? Nod your head if you think you hear with this part of your ear, the part that sticks out. Oh, no, you guessed wrong. You don't. This part of your ear, this little saucer, a big saucer, sticks out and it catches sound, but that's all it does. You could still hear without it. The sound travels down this tube in your outer ear to your eardrum. Here, let me show you. There it is. I think you can guess how the eardrum got its name. It vibrates when sound strikes it, just like a toy drum does when you hit it. In the middle ear, that's on this side of the eardrum, are the three tiniest bones in your body. 1, 2, 3. They pass sound along, and the sound gets stronger as it passes from bone to bone. The third bone passes the sound along in here to the coiled up tube in your inner ear. The inner ear has thousands of tiny hairs in it, and it's filled with a liquid. The sound goes around and around in the inner ear, making the liquid move, and that tickles all those thousands of little hairs, sending a signal along the big nerve that carries messages to your brain, and you get the message. I bet you didn't know the ear was so complicated that there was so much to it, did you? Suppose you don't hear very well. What if every sound you hear were as low as my voice is now? You can't put glasses on your ears. What can you do to make your hearing normal? Well, some people who don't hear well wear a hearing aid that makes the vibrations that strike their eardrum stronger. And believe me, wearing a hearing aid is a lot better than not hearing what goes on around you. So you see, people who don't see well and don't hear well don't have to give up knowing about things, and they certainly don't have to give up learning. Maybe they can get help for their eyes or their ears. Or they can use their other sense organs instead. People who don't hear well can use their other sense organs, especially, their eyes, right, to help them learn. And people who don't see well can use their other sense organs too, especially their ears, right, to help them learn. Did you ever stop to think about it? What a great team they are, your eyes and your ears. They work together all your lifetime, bringing in billions and trillions of sights and sounds, making being alive the exciting thing that it is.
Thank you.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Have you ever stopped to think how many things you do with your hands? Watch. Those things with your hands? Of course you can, and many other things besides. Your hands are a very important part of you. Even from the day when you were first born, if someone put their finger in your hand, you took hold and held on, like this. And from that small beginning, every day, you've been discovering more and different things to do with your hands. It's that way with all people. These are just some of the things that people have learned to do with their hands that helps make life easier for us today. People have always been able to communicate with their hands, probably in any language. This means come here, and this means stop, and this means goodbye, and I don't know, right. Hands have helped build homes for people, like this igloo. Although it's made of snow and ice, the family inside is safe and warm. Hands have planted seeds, plowed fields, gathered crops, prepared food, so that people would always have enough to eat. Hands have shaped wheels and made carts and tamed animals so that people could move their things from place to place. Hands have made tools so the work could be done faster and so that people would have more time for fun. Hands have made printing presses and published books so that people could learn to read and understand more. Hands have made beautiful things to make life more enjoyable. And hands have made musical instruments, and they make music. Without hands to do all these things, our life would probably be very different today. We might be living more like cows or kangaroos. What is it that makes your hands so useful? Look at them. What do you see? Five fingers? Yes? Oh, four fingers and a thumb. Okay. What can you do with your fingers? You can wave them, bend them, you can curl them. What else? Can you touch each finger to your thumb like this? Suppose you couldn't do this, would it make a big difference? Could you get along without using your thumbs? My friend Ben tried to build a dinosaur model without using his thumbs. And, well, let's see how he did. To make sure that he wouldn't use his thumbs without thinking about it, he taped them down. With a lot of pieces. This is probably when Ben began to wish he had a third hand to work with. One to hold the dinosaur, one to put on the leg. Thank you. always start with the little pieces. The little pieces you usually hold between your thumb and your index finger. See, that's what happens when you're all fingers. There. Oops. Well, you see, he finally finished making the dinosaur model. But it took him a lot longer than he thought it was going to. Doing things without using your thumbs is like trying to see using only one eye. You can do it, but it isn't easy. It's because we can make that circle between the thumb and the finger that makes our hands so handy. What is it that's inside your hands that makes them so useful? Bones and muscles, right. Without bones and muscles to move those bones, your hands would be like two empty gloves, all flippy and floppy. You'd have to figure out some other way to get things done. Maybe you'd have to use your teeth or your elbows or your nose or your feet even. Now, wouldn't that be unhandy? There's one other thing that's inside your hands that's important. Can you guess what I'm thinking of? Nerves, good. Because you have so many nerves making the connection between your brain and your hands, you know exactly what things feel like. Sometimes you can even tell what a thing is just by feeling it. You know, someone left a bag of things on my table yesterday, and I have no idea what's inside. Suppose I close my eyes tight and see if I can guess what's inside just by using my hands. There's a lot of things in there. Here's something that's cool and smooth and round. Is it made of glass? No, it's really very heavy, and I can't scratch it with my nail. Oh, is it a stone? Let's see. Yes, good, that was easy. Let's try another one. Here's something else that's cool and smooth and round. Whoops, but my nail goes right through. Here's a stem. Oh, I know, it's an apple. No, wait a minute. It's not an apple shape, it's a pear shape. Let's see. Yes, it's a pear, good. This is easy. Here's something that's furry. It's not a mitten because I can't put my fingers in it. Oh, I know, it must be a furry animal with a tail. With two tails and a flat part to stand on. I have to look. Oh, isn't that cute? It's an Eskimo doll with two pigtails. Well, I came close. An animal covered with fur stands on two feet. Let's see, what else is in here? Here's something very light in weight, and it's rough, and it has things sticking out around it. Oh my goodness, there's lots of things sticking out. I give up. A spider! Ooh, goodbye. Now I'm not so sure I want to go back in the bag again. Here's a soft cube, like an eraser. Whoops, it's not an eraser, it's changing shape. It's getting longer. And longer. It stretches. It's elastic. And it all goes back together again in a ball. I know. Is it a ball of silly putty? Yes. Oh, well, now that's not bad. I guessed all but one, and I came close on this one. My hands must be pretty smart. Of course, it's not really your hands that are smart. Monkeys have hands. Baboons have hands. Chimps have hands. I almost forgot. I have a visitor out on the porch I want you to meet. Hi, Larry.
Hello.
Oh, so this is Joe.
Yes.
Hey, Joe. Joe's a chimpanzee, and this is Larry, his trainer.
Yeah.
We're talking about hands today, Larry. Could you show us one of Joe's hands?
Sure. See your hand, Joe. See your hand.
He has the same number of joints that we have.
Yes.
Nails. Look at that. His thumb's a lot shorter in comparison to the fingers than ours.
Yes.
Why is that?
He uses these four fingers here for walking in the wild. And most of his strength is mainly in those four fingers. He doesn't use it as much as a human uses his thumb, and it stays smaller.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's interesting. Joe. They do look powerful. What are you doing with the book, Joe?
Joe, here.
You know what to do with a book? Careful.
Come here.
Just like I do with a book earlier, I leaf through with my thumbs like that. He's seen people looking at books before. He knows exactly what to do. What would you think if we gave him something? Will he reach for a new toy?
Yes, I think so. Joe, you want this?
Joe, would you like that toy? Oh, look at him reach.
Yeah. Sit up. I think he's oval playful with this toy.
He grabs it with his feet, too.
Yes,
they look like hands.
They use their feet equally as much as they use their hands. It's like four hands.
Look at him. He's got one ring in his mouth.
Yeah, Joe.
One ring on his fingers. Just like a kid, he takes the toys apart.
Very curious. They're very curious. Here.
Joe, do you know where that goes?
He found a finger for it now.
He's got a ring on his finger. What's this? Would this be Joe's hat?
Yes, he wears this. He goes motorcycle riding once in a while.
Oh.
He doesn't care for it as much unless he's riding, then he doesn't bother with it.
Oh, he doesn't care for that? I've got something here that I brought through with me. Oh, is he curious? What do you think of that, Joe? That's my little Eskimo doll.
He's gonna read some more, I guess.
And hold the Eskimo doll at his foot. Oh. So, here's a chimpanzee that can leaf through a book, take a toy apart, hold a doll. But do you think he could ever read a book or bring up a baby, a human baby, or design a toy or design a hat? Why not? That's right, the answer is up here. Joe's a smart chimpanzee. But does that mean that he's very smart? Does he mean he's as smart as you? No, he's not the smartest animal in all the world. It's the one you see every time you look in the mirror.
Supported public television, WSK.
It doesn't stop when you graduate or reach a certain age. We are all of us learning even now. You see something unexpected and you let it take you to a new place. It's not important to understand.